Back students, in the earlier video we have discussed what compulsory winding up is and the circumstances in which a company is wound up by the tribunal, and also we have discussed who has a right to file a petition, isn't it? So in the earlier video we have discussed that there are certain powers for a tribunal in case of compulsory winding up, isn't it? In that powers, one of the important powers is the tribunal has the power to appoint a liquidator in order to look into the winding up proceedings, isn't it? Now, we have to discuss who is a liquidator, what are his powers and what are his duties in case of compulsory winding up. Clear? So, let's go on to the topic, liquidator. So, who is a liquidator? Generally, a liquidator is a person who is appointed by the tribunal in order to look into the affairs of a winding up committee. Clear? And this liquidator is generally appointed by the tribunal from the panel maintained by the central government. And this panel generally consists of chartered accountants, company secretary, cost accountants and advocates who is having 10 plus years of experience in company affairs. So from that panel, a suitable person will be selected by the tribunal in order to be a liquidator of a company. Clear? And coming to the powers of a liquidator. Generally, there are certain powers which are generally given to a liquidator. And there are certain powers which are given and which will be taken by the liquidator with the mere sanction of the tribunal. What are those? So the powers of a liquidator can be divided into two. The first one is powers exercised with sanction of tribunal. And the second one is powers exercised without sanction of tribunal. So sanction here means permission. So coming to the powers exercised with the permission of tribunal, the first one is to carry on the business. So the liquidator has the power to carry on the business of the wind up company with the permission of the tribunal. And the second power is to sell properties of the company. And the third power is to carry legal proceedings in the name of the company. That is, if the company is involved in any litigation or any case, then the liquidator has the power to carry on the legal proceedings in the name of the company. And the next one is to pay claims. That is, if any amount is to be paid to creditors or employees, then that claims can be settled by the liquidator with the help of, with the permission of tribunal. And the next one is to distribute money in case of winding up. That is, if any money has to be distributed to members, contributories, debtors or creditors, that amount can be distributed by the liquidator with the permission of tribunal. And coming the next power, that is powers exercised without the permission of tribunal. That is, without taking any permission of the court, the liquidator can exercise certain powers. Among that, the first one is to inspect records, files of the company from registrar. Generally, if any third party want to inspect files and records from the registrar of companies, then he has to take the permission of registrar and he has to pay prescribed fee for inspecting any record or file of any company. But here, the liquidator has the power to inspect the record and files of the wind-up company from the registrar of company without paying any fees. And the second one is, the liquidator has the power to use the seal of the company to execute any deeds relating to the company. And the third one is to obtain professional assistance. That is, if the liquidator needs any professional assistance from any professionals in case of winding up, then that professional assistance can be taken by the liquidator. And the third one, next one is to appoint agent to look after the proceedings of winding up. That is, if the liquidator alone cannot carry on the winding up proceedings, then the liquidator has the power to appoint an agent to assist him in case of winding up. And the last, next power is to take all actions for winding up. Whatever preventive measures have to be taken in order to wind up a company, that measures can be taken by the liquidator without the permission of tribunal. And the last one is to appoint chartered accountant. If the liquidator want to value the current assets, value the assets of a company, then the liquidator has the power to appoint chartered accountants. So Now coming to the duties of liquidator. So what are the different duties a liquidator is entitled to? The first duty of a liquidator is to file a declaration. So once a person is appointed as a liquidator, so the first duty what he has to do is he has to file a declaration in prescribed form to the tribunal within 7 days of his appointment. That is, within 7 days of being appointed as a liquidator, the person has to file a declaration to the tribunal stating his interest as well as his interest of being appointed as liquidator. Clear? The second duty is to constitute a winding up committee. So a liquidator alone cannot look after the affairs of a wind up committee. So here, the second duty of a liquidator is to constitute a winding up committee in order to assist the liquidator to carry on the winding up proceedings of a company. So this winding up committee generally consists of the liquidator himself, next a nominee from the secured creditors, and professionals who are nominated by the tribunals. So these three tiers generally constitute a winding up committee. And this winding up committee should be constituted within 3 weeks of being appointed as a liquidator. And once this duty is also finished, the next duty what he has to do is to submit report of winding up committee to the tribunal. So once a winding up committee is constituted by the liquidator, these winding up committee should look after the affairs of the company to be wound up. And what the liquidator has to do is, he has to submit a monthly report of the proceedings which are carried on in the company to the tribunal. Clear? And next, the fourth one is to submit preliminary report of winding up. So next, and the main duty of the liquidator is, once winding up order has been passed to a company, within 60 days of passing a winding up order, the liquidator has to submit a preliminary report to the tribunal. So what does this preliminary report actually contains? So this preliminary report generally contains following information. The first one is nature and details of assets of the company. What are the assets of the company? The location of the assets, by whom it is held, cash in hand, cash at bank, the negotiable instruments of the company. These all information should be stated in preliminary report. And the next one is amount of capital. What is the issued capital, subscribed capital? That information should also be stated. And the third one is, what is the existing and contingent liabilities of the company? That is the name and address. The occupation of the creditors should be stated in detail in the preliminary report. And the next one is debts due to the company. Who are our debtors? Their address, their occupation should be stated in detail in preliminary report. And the next is, if any guarantee is given by the company, that guarantor's name should also be extended in the preliminary report. And if the company has any subsidiary company or the company has any holding company, the details of subsidiary company and the holding company should also be mentioned in the preliminary report. And the next one is, if any legal cases are filed in the name of the company or the company has filed legal cases against any company, then that legal proceedings as well as the cases information should be mentioned in preliminary report. And the next one is, if the company has entered into any contracts with any company, either joint contracts or corporation contracts or joint agreements, then the details of those contracts should be mentioned in the preliminary report. And the next one is the manner in which company is promoted. Okay, who are the promoters of the company? Their name, address. If any defraud is being committed by the promoters, all those information should be mentioned in the preliminary report. Clear? So this is the fourth one. And coming to the fifth duty, to call meetings of creditors and contributories. So at any time, if the liquidator feels that a meeting of creditors and contributories are essential to the company, then it is the duty of the liquidator to call up meetings of creditors and liquidators and clarify matters relating to winding up. And the last duty is to maintain proper books. Once a winding up order has been issued in the name of the company, it is the liquidator who has to maintain proper books from the time of winding up order. Clear? So I am coming to the next one, that is effect of winding up order. So these are the duties and what is the effect of a winding up order. So once a compulsory winding up order has been passed in the name of the company, then what is the effect of that winding up order? So this winding up order has three effects. The first one is stay out of suits. That is, no legal cases can be filed in the name of the company when winding up order has been issued in the name of the company. And the second effect is custody of company's properties. All the assets of the companies or properties of the company will be under the control of liquidator when a winding up order has been issued. And the last effect is full cooperation. So when a winding up order has been issued in the name of the company, then all the directors, members, shareholders, creditors, contributories has to extend their full cooperation to the liquidator in case of winding up order. Thank you.